But it's probably not exhaust. I hear you. Sorry about the heat, there's nothing we can do about that. Share this vehicle now going wrong way. A failure to yield. CHP right behind that vehicle. This is Vermont, right about 78th Street. We have to hold a long shot just through the LAX airspace, but that suspect vehicle weaving back into lanes over here onto the right side of the road into that number two lane. Only going about 15, 25 miles an hour for a majority of this pursuit. What we're understanding is that this may be involved in some sort of narcotics case by the LA County Sheriff's Department. We haven't fully gotten that confirmed yet. However, the Sheriff's Air Unit was overhead originally. Now the CHP Air Unit has taken over, but only holding about 25 miles an hour. A passenger has already foot bailed from the vehicle and has been taken into custody. The CHP is still hot on the tail of this suspect. They are thinking of different ways to bring this pursuit to an end. Some of those include spike strips, pit maneuvers, things like that. They've been talking to their supervisors about the different options there, and it looks like they have a plan to bring this to an end when the right opportunity arises. But in some cases, they have to wait for, say, we look at a pit maneuver, a pit qualified vehicle, a pit qualified driver to be able to successfully do that that maneuver. Now we are going to be transitioning through the airspace here. My pilot David Biskovich got permission for us to transition, so we're going to lose it for just a second, but we'll pick it right back up. It's right behind those buildings there. The CHP is still on the tail of this failure to yield suspect. It's been going on, this pursuit been going on for at least 20 minutes now. We are just getting overhead, but you can see the blinking lights in the distance there. We had to drop to a lower altitude to make it through this airspace to stay out of the way of those passenger jets that are landing at Los Angeles International, but we'll pop up here shortly. But the suspect is still in that right side of traffic, in that number one lane, going about 25 miles an hour, has three units behind it right now, a primary vehicle that is focused on that suspect vehicle, a backup vehicle, as well as a supervisor in this pursuit with an airship overhead. On the other end of that radio, we do have the dispatcher there who is trying to coordinate with the other agencies like the Sheriff's Department, and in this area, the LAPD, who has jurisdiction on the roadways here, but the CHP has not handed it over to the LAPD. We keep seeing little glimpses of that that pursuit coming to shots as we kind of weave between the buildings here. Still northbound Vermont coming up to Slauson, still about 25 miles an hour from what we're hearing. There's that red Honda CRV there, speeding up just a little bit in a little bit more traffic. This is the most traffic we've seen since this pursuit has began. Luckily, lower speeds at this time of day with the commuter traffic here in the LA area as people start to get back to work. But we're just continuing to work northbound here. Soon we'll be able to pop up and see this from above a little better. But the CHP is right on this suspect's tail. They're saying, we're not going anywhere. It's best you give up, or we'll be here until you do. And they may be using those different tactics to bring this pursuit to an end, including that pit maneuver, which I can tell you from experience is a very interesting maneuver for those officers to do. They train a lot for that tactic too in pursuits, as being drivers, we're taught from the beginning that we don't want to hit cars, right? And now wrong side of the road there, that CHP unit getting right on the tail of that vehicle. Lights and sirens going, not only to notify this vehicle it's supposed to pull over, but also to notify the public that there's a dangerous situation there too. And you can see how that vehicle just keeps popping up on the on the vehicle, trying to find that perfect moment to do that pit maneuver, but it just hasn't been quite right yet. Speeding up here about 45 miles an hour. This is the fastest we've seen it since this pursuit has been brought on air. There it is, slowing down for that red light. CHP right on this suspect's tail. Just waiting for the best moment to bring this to an end. They got to think about the other vehicles in the area. They don't want to spin this vehicle out of control and hit a bystander, especially with all that traffic there. But CHP going to pop up right on that bumper saying, we're here. We're going to bring this to an end one way or another. And we're ready to use that pit maneuver if necessary. But you can see as we get a little closer, now coming to the north, still here on Vermont, all the way over to that right shoulder. Earlier, this suspect was actually on the sidewalks in one part of this pursuit, and we're turning, was going to turn, but saw that CHP unit there, still northbound Vermont through Vernon now, about 30 miles an hour, speeding up here. And looking out your rearview mirror, that suspect probably saw that CHP unit right on their tail and began to speed up a little bit, trying to get it out of the way. But that primary unit there staying in the pursuit still as we continue northbound Vermont, coming up on 42nd Street, that air unit overhead calling the pursuit so that those ground units can focus on driving. Wrong way of the street here, very dangerous. Luckily stopped traffic, but a very dangerous pursuit here as we go through South L.A., now approaching up here near USC and the Coliseum, Cher. Cher, they have been authorized for that pit maneuver. That supervisor that is involved in the pursuit has given that authorization. So now they've just been working on getting the right unit in place with the right equipment on the vehicle as well as the right driver in place to complete that pit maneuver in a safe environment. Now, there are some factors that come into effect when we talk about pit maneuvers. One of those, like we were talking about, is the innocent bystanders, the danger to the public, the danger to property in the area. Is it safe for them to do so for both the officers, the public, as well as that driver, as well as the speeds? There's a very specific speed range that the suspect has to be within to complete a successful pit that won't put a majority of people in danger. So those are all factors that they have to consider, including the car size. Now, this is a smaller SUV, as we see here, this red Honda CR-V, a little older model. CHP SUVs, as well as those Dodge Chargers that they do drive, are comparable and can complete that pit maneuver on a vehicle of this size. We start seeing size problems when we talk about like large trucks or ambulances, things like that. We've seen a pursuit in the past. However, in this case, that won't be the case. Southbound now, Figaro, coming up on 42nd, still holding about 25 miles an hour, coming on that stop traffic. And every time we come to that stop traffic, the suspect decides to go wrong way, but a lot of traffic here, so had to just hold that center divider there. You can see the public doing the right thing, hearing those sirens, seeing those lights, and moving to the right shoulder like they should, giving the officers the area to do their work. Again, we're going to run into the same problem here going southbound is we have to hold outside of that airspace until we get permission from LAX. So we'll have a little bit longer a shot, but it looks like this suspect is continuing just southbound here on Vernon through Vernon, I'm sorry, and still going about 30 miles an hour, that CHP charger right on the suspect's tail. Now, this charger has been on this pursuit since we arrived. However, there was a handoff between the East LA CHP and the South LA CHP. And what the CHP does is they have different divisions, different offices throughout the Southern California area. And when pursuits go through their territories, through their jurisdictions, they hand off between each other. The best way to describe it is kind of like a leapfrog or like a relay race. And that brings new drivers, new tanks of gas to the pursuit, and lets that know the area the best, so that those other officers can go back to their jurisdictions. Still continuing southbound now, Figueroa, about 51st Street, holding about 30 miles an hour. Not stopping for those red lights. What we understand is this is a failure to yield from the CHP. The Sheriff's Department said it may be involved in some sort of narcotics crime or situation, so that is of interest with this possible suspect here, but still in that left-hand turn pocket, slowing down to make sure there's no cross traffic, and continuing through that intersection there, Figueroa at about 55th Street, about 35 miles an hour, and this has just been the name of the pursuit. We haven't seen it get on the freeway at any point, sticking to those side streets. Now, it was going a bit faster earlier when this first started, with that passenger in the vehicle, but the passenger did leave the vehicle, and the CHP had eyes on that passenger earlier. We've been sticking with the driver of the vehicle. You can see pedestrians out on the side of the street. Very dangerous for people to be there. I want to avoid these situations at all costs, and same with all those individuals in their cars on these streets too. The police don't want them around this as well, especially if this comes to an end. You never know how these pursuits are going to end. Is it going to end in an accident? Is it going to end with a shootout? Is it going to end peacefully? We really don't know, so the police are going to try to keep as many people away from this as possible, but in this situation, it does seem that we are at the suspect's pleasure as to where this pursuit goes. Now, it's still southbound Figueroa, about Gage, heavy traffic ahead into that center divider, into that turn pocket. You see the northbound traffic moving to the side, the southbound traffic holding there, letting this pursuit go by. A left-hand turn signal on. We'll see what the suspect does, and they are turning right. We're turning westbound now on about 65th Street, so we'll see it pop out here just in a few moments as we continue to the west. But this is a hard... yeah, Cher, we can't go right over it due to that LAX airspace. There we are, southbound now on Hoover, it looks like. But that might be the wrong vehicle. There's the right vehicle. Just too many red cars down here, Cher. But we have to stay outside the airspace to let the air unit work over this. Now, this is the approach area for LAX. So even the air unit sometimes has troubles in this area. So we will often hear the ground units pick up calling this pursuit while that air unit has to stay out of the way so that airplanes can land. But the LAX air traffic controller is doing a great job of letting the CHP airship work in there. They're just holding us out for safety purposes for both those passenger jets as well as between all the media ships and the LA and the CHP. It can get very congested and it can become a dangerous situation that no one wants to be in. So the safest option is to kind of stay out of it, and our controllers are doing a great job of keeping us in the right place to keep everyone safe, just like the police on the ground are doing their best to keep everyone safe from this suspect driver in this pursuit. And it looks like we're going back eastbound now on about 73rd from Hoover, still holding about 15, 20 miles an hour, and we'll lose them just again for a second. But you can see CHP is right behind. They're not going to lose this. They're over the overhead and on that ground, that airship overhead, calling the pursuit for those officers on the ground so that other agencies in the area are aware of the situation. Other officers are. The supervisors know what's going on both here on scene as well as those back at the communications building as well. As well as, let's talk about when this pursuit comes to an end. If the suspect decides to foot bail and run away, that airship has a lot better of a vantage point overhead to walk those officers in on where that suspect is hiding and keep a better eye on that suspect so that those officers can focus on being safe and taking whatever precautions they need to apprehend the suspect successfully. Back southbound on Figueroa, about 77th Street, still heavy traffic on that northbound side. We're going southbound now coming up on some more traffic here. A very very heavy traffic this time of day. Almost every red light the suspect seems to have hit. And so it's slow, but the suspect is still making progress here at 510, 511 as it makes its way through the rush hour as we know it now here in South L.A., Cher. That's what it looks like, Sheriff. Five black and whites. That's the 110 freeway there. We're going eastbound now, so we'll see the suspect pop out on the other side here shortly. You see the red and blue flashing lights. We'll see what happens here. Wrong way now. And now turning up an alley here northbound off of Grand, or this is Grand, going through 88th Street now. You see CHP right there. 1, 2, 3, 4. And it looks like another truck that's following along as well. Not sure their relation. But that's a little more than a normal pursuit, but this pursuit's been going on for quite some time. We'll try to see which way it pops out here. And northbound on Broadway. So we'll see it pops up here. There we are. Suspect vehicle. Northbound Broadway from 84th Street, slowing down for the traffic, just missing that car that thought they had the clearance. Northbound the CHP still talking about the different tactics they can use. They could consider a spike strip, but with a spike strip, what comes there is they have to see some sort of a predictable nature with that suspect. And right now, we've just kind of been weaving our way through the maze of the streets down here in Los Angeles. So it's really hard for them to lay out those spike strips and pop those tires just due to the unpredictable nature of where this suspect's going to go. But still continuing northbound Broadway through about 80th, you see that primary vehicle right on the suspect's tail, that secondary vehicle, and then that supervisor in the rear. And it looks like we're right on that suspect's tail, slowing down again. That charger coming up, still not the right moment. And maybe they know something now about this suspect that is preventing that pit maneuver. So we've talked about the physical attributes in terms of scenarios in which a pit maneuver can work and can't in terms of speed and location, things like that. But there are other attributes as well that are more situational in the sense of if they know that the suspect is armed or things like that. The last thing that the police want to do is spin that car around, have that suspect facing those officers head on, and if they know that there's a possible weapon in there or they have a strong hunch that there's a weapon in there, they don't want the chance of that suspect being able to easily face those officers and shoot at them. So they're thinking of those aspects as well. So we're not exactly sure of why they're not doing that pit maneuver right now, but it still seems like that's not the option that they're choosing. Now eastbound 74th Street through Main, another option that the officers can kind of focus on, especially this driver, while they are erratic and they are driving dangerously wrong way, jumping through red lights and rolling through stop signs, is they might just try to see how long they can wait until the suspect runs out of gas. Now, in some situations, those when we see the super high speed pursuits, it's the opposite, is where we see vehicles disarm or brake themselves from going at those high rates of speed when they're not made for that. But with these low rates of speed, that's something we don't have to worry about as much. But those CHP cruisers are filled with gas. They can swap out as needed if that is necessary due to maintenance issues, due to fuel issues. That suspect vehicle doesn't have that pleasure. Green light here through that red light that suspect's going. Luckily, the traffic heard those sirens and still yielded to that intersection, allowing this suspect vehicle to make their way through. But this is where it gets dangerous, is we have very busy streets down here, both on those more commercial streets with traffic trying to get home from a long day's work, but also as we get into the residential areas, people are getting home and kids are playing outside, things like that. So these are all considerations that the police and the CHP that are involved in this pursuit have to take into account as they follow this pursuit to keep everyone safe. We're making another little turn here to try to get around the airspace as it's actually exiting the LAX airspace as we continue to the east. So we're going to lose it for just a second. And here it pops out. You can see just the glimmer of the red vehicle there. But now we're working southbound on Central from 75th Street. And still going about 25 miles an hour. That air unit's still right overhead. The CHP unit's still right behind, and they're going to follow this vehicle share until this suspect gives up or that they have the right moment to bring this to a safe ending. Eastbound. That's right, Chair. What we understand is there was at least two people in this vehicle when this pursuit started, a driver and a passenger. That passenger has left the vehicle. They foot bailed just before we arrived overhead about 25 minutes ago. The CHP had eyes on that passenger and what we understand is that passenger has been apprehended. Now we're eastbound on Firestone. We've been on Firestone before. This is where we first heard the pursuit. And so we're working our way back eastbound and making our way towards Alameda now. And so this is coming towards us now, which makes it a little easier for us to see. But what we understand is only one individual in that vehicle. Now we're seeing bystanders on the corner, looks like cheering on the pursuit, shooting with their phones, and that's a very dangerous situation to be in, Cher. As if this pursuit ends, now the police not only have to worry about apprehending the suspect, but they have to worry about the public and keeping them safe, and that becomes a very high priority for them. And so it's best when you learn of a pursuit or you hear one to go inside, lock the doors, because you never know how these are going to end, and then just watch it on KTLA Plus or on TV with our KTLA Channel 5, as we'll be over it, and that's a lot safer, and we get a lot of better closer angles to it than anyone on the corner can. Eastbound through Main, it looks like we're under the overpass here. CHP all over the place in all the lanes, trying to predict where this suspect's going to go. Wrong side of the road now. Very dangerous situation here. Luckily, not a lot of traffic going the opposite direction. Back into the middle or center divider. Stock traffic at this signal here. We'll see what the suspect does. It looks like we're going back on the right side of the road. Now we're past that traffic. Motorcyclist there. Looks like they were just about to go through that intersection, so glad they waited just a second. And still eastbound Firestone coming up on Bandera, still about 45 miles an hour. Clearer roads this way, and a very wide road as well. So if that pit maneuver is still approved, which we haven't heard anything otherwise, but we still haven't seen any attempts quite yet, this would be a great spot for them to think about doing that, just due to the wide open space and very few vehicles and cross traffic. You can see vehicles getting out of the way as they hear those sirens and see those lights come around that corner. This suspect wanted for failure to yield by the CHP now. It's going about 41 miles an hour, still on Firestone, coming up to just about Alameda here, here in the Florence area. Now, the dispatchers are on their phones, on their radios, communicating with the other agencies in the area, including the Sheriff's Department. So if this does come to an end, the other agencies that do have these jurisdictions down here can come and assist in the termination, come look for the suspect if they decide to run. So very important work by the dispatchers back at the communication centers, all coordinating on this pursuit. But let's try to get a look inside the vehicle now that we're a little closer. It looks like we have a driver, and I see something kind of moving in that passenger seat, but I can't tell if it's a passenger or just maybe something hanging from the mirror. But definitely that driver in that black long sleeve there, looks like not a care in the world, just driving along, coming up on this intersection, looking to make sure it's clear and working our way through, and continuing still eastbound on Firestone. Through about Long Beach Boulevard here in the Southgate area. Now, Southgate PD is in the area, but they're probably not going to get involved unless the CHP asks them to. So the way the kind of jurisdictions work with pursuits a lot of the time is an agency will start the pursuit, including the CHP, but in this case, it sounds like the Sheriff's Department was involved at first, and they will request the CHP to take over. And once the CHP takes over the pursuit, southbound Long Beach from Firestone now, but once the CHP take over the pursuit, they make all the other agencies get out of the pursuit because they don't need the extra vehicles behind it. They don't need to have to worry about that. They just need to focus on the pursuit. So they send all those other vehicles away, all the other agencies away, and then they take over the pursuit. And then if it works too much in a certain area or a certain jurisdiction, they may request that a jurisdiction like the sheriff's or the LAPD or one of the smaller cities take that pursuit back over. But in this case, just due to the large span of area that the pursuit is covered, the CHP has decided to continue with this pursuit, even though it is on surface streets and isn't in necessarily their jurisdiction, which is the freeways. But they are still sticking with this vehicle, wanted for failure to yield. We are hearing that it may be involved, it's not confirmed, but may be involved with some sort of narcotics investigation. So that might be something as well, but we're still trying to get that confirmed. Just going to look in that that driver's side window again as we have the opportunity. And I don't think I see anyone in that passenger seat. It looks pretty clear. I don't see anyone moving or anything like that. I'm slowing down here at Long Beach and Tweedy. And now we are going back to the west, westbound Tweedy from Long Beach. And this is kind of the area that the pursuit started. When we first heard it being reported by the sheriff's airship, this is about where it was, and it kind of just wove its way through the streets here, spent a lot of time on Firestone. So this may be where the suspect is comfortable. This may be where they're from. We don't know, but a lot of the times we see that suspects go back to areas that they are comfortable so that if they are going to foot bail or something like that, they at least know where they're going or they know the terrain. But the CHP is right on this suspect's tail, and they aren't letting up anytime soon, Cher. It does look that way, Cher. It's really hard for us to see through there, being on the driver's side. But if the vehicle does turn around, we'll definitely try to take a look on that passenger side just to confirm. But at least one passenger, we heard that passenger get out. But if we're seeing movement in that passenger seat, it's possible that there might be other people in that vehicle as well. With those dark tinted windows, it makes it a little tough as well. But like you were saying, Cher, very dangerous to be out conversing with the suspect in a pursuit or getting involved at all. That just puts yourself as well as others as at risk. And in some situations, those people that try to get involved are even stopped by the police and questioned and can be in some way connected to an accessory. We've seen people give food to suspects and stuff in the past, and that's just not a place that's best to be. It's best to watch it on TV and let those police do their work because their main goal is keeping everyone safe, and anyone else getting involved just makes that a lot more complicated. Wrong side of the road now, southbound Alameda at about a 111th Street. Stop traffic in that southbound lanes, wrong side of the road, we'll have to see what happens here. Luckily, no traffic on that northbound side for the most part. They had all stopped there, hadn't started yet. About 50 miles an hour now, still continuing southbound in the Linwood area, we're going to be coming up shortly to the 105 freeway, so we'll see what the suspect does there. But we've just done a big square westbound on Imperial from Alameda, and this is about where we picked up the pursuit before we came on air. So suspect's done a huge square, kind of touring Los Angeles, the South L.A. area, and made their way on this exact stretch of road before. Another wide stretch of road that could be a positive in a pit maneuver. However, the CHP is still sticking behind that same unit in that primary position. Again, their main focus is keeping the public safe. So when they come up to intersections like that are full, they're not going to rush through the intersections like the driver might. They're gonna slow down because they don't want to get in any accidents or cause any accidents with the public. So they'll let that air unit do its work and call it from above, and then they'll catch up when it deems safe. You can see how they kind of backed off a bit as it's made its way through these more complicated and congested intersections. Still westbound Imperial coming up on Wilmington, and we're just making our way to the west now. You can see the vehicles kind of merging out of the way as they see those lights and hear those sirens. We're just continuing here to the west, a somewhat slow speed pursuit compared to what we're usually seeing, Cher, but still all the danger involved with the suspect going wrong way. And we're not exactly sure what's going on in that suspect, in that vehicle, if there's anyone else in there, or what the exact situation of why this suspect ran from the police. Who knows if they have other wants or if there's any other situations involved. But those are all things that the police have to take into account as they continue this pursuit. Very busy intersection, car turning left there. If they would have turned into that number one lane, could have been really bad, but luckily that car had made that wide turn. Still going westbound Imperial through Compton. And this pursuit now going on nearly an hour. We've been covering it for about 35 minutes live, but a very, very dangerous situation here in South L.A. That's right, Micah, and a lot of that is based on circumstance. What do they know about the vehicle that we don't? And they might know something, and like we were talking about earlier, is possibly the suspect's armed, possibly there's some other situation involved where that tactic of a pit maneuver isn't the safest option for the public, for the driver, for the officers themselves. So they might be a little more hesitant at using that unless it's absolutely necessary. And so in this situation, it looks like they're just content to follow the suspect until the suspect pulls over or in some other way the pursuit is brought to an end. But we'll just have to wait and see. The streets are very busy this time of day, and the speeds have been ranging in and out of that kind of golden area for a pit maneuver. So they might just be waiting for that exact right moment when there's no one around where it's the exact right speed, because too fast, car spins out of control, can cause a lot of damage, hurt a lot of people. Too slow, the pit maneuver isn't effective at all. And then just making sure they have the right vehicles and the right people in the right spots to do that, and then manage the situation after that pit maneuver is done. Still westbound Imperial Highway, and we're making our way over some railroad tracks, going back to the 110 area, Imperial Highway and Lancet. And stopping for traffic, very busy intersection here. This is kind of the most we've seen them stop, but just going to weave through those cars there as we continue on. And that's just the scenario that we've been watching for the last 35, 40 minutes now, is this vehicle come up on intersections with stop traffic, people just trying to get home or to their next location for the day, and not knowing what's going on. And then a vehicle zooming by them, running through the intersection, and police lights and sirens and vehicles right behind them. And that can be very disorienting for the public. I can tell you from experience, just a few days ago, I had a pursuit go right by me on my drive into work. And I cover pursuits for a living. And I was kind of taken back and didn't know what to do for a split second. So you can imagine what these hundreds of drivers this suspect is passing, what type of stress that's causing. Wow, we're right there, just hitting that car and just missing it, hopefully. But a very, very dangerous situation. And that's the type of stuff we're worried about seeing is vehicles not seeing the suspect vehicle, not hearing the police sirens, and following their normal tactics, and then getting involved in this. We've already heard of one actual collision earlier in the pursuit, about when that passenger got out of the vehicle, and so this vehicle has at least struck at least one other vehicle, and almost maybe two there. We're unsure. We haven't heard of any damages come out of that vehicle that was involved in that intersection there, but the suspect still continuing northbound Broadway, coming up on 108th Street, 108th Street, passing that school bus there. You can see vehicles trying to yield, get out of the way, but this is not what you're expecting on your drive home, Micah, at this time of night, 5:30 in the evening. That's right. Now you can see more pedestrians out there getting involved, getting in the middle of the street. Very dangerous situation, both when you're on the curb as well as when you're off. Not good to block traffic like that. We're still continuing north around Broadway, coming up on Florence. Now, this is in the LAX airspace again, so we have to stay out of it. But that CHP airship is still overhead, calling this pursuit for those officers on the ground. Like you were saying, we've just kind of been doing a big circle of this area of Los Angeles. Now, with that, that could bring some good strategy in terms of where to place a spike strip, just due to the nature of the suspect kind of sticking on certain streets. The CHP has people that are looking at all those options, those supervisors that are deciding which options are best to bring this to an end. And right now it looks like they're deeming the best option is to let it go. It's not going at high rates of speed, and it's just continuing at about 30, 40 miles an hour as we continue northbound here. 63rd Street, still northbound on Broadway. We'll see what happens here as we continue, but a very long shot for us, unfortunately, just due to the airspace and having to let those passenger jets get through there and get into LAX, get those people to their next destination. But you see a large presence of CHP behind this vehicle. Now, I can tell you that those two vehicles you see right behind that lowest CHP vehicle have kind of been following this for a good portion of the pursuit. So we're not sure how they're involved, but it's best if you see a pursuit, stay away and don't tail it, because you never know how these are going to end. Are they going to end in an accident? Are they going to end in some sort of altercation between the police and the suspect? We really don't know. So it's best just to stay away. But they are following a trail. It's possible those are even possibly undercover officers or deputies from another agency that are involved in this, that know more about the wants and why this suspect is running from the police. But right now, the CHP, all they're giving us, all they can confirm is that the suspect failed to stop when they tried to pull the suspect over. It's a failure to yield. We're hearing possibly that there's some sort of narcotics investigation involved. But just ahead here, we see officers blocking off the intersection. So we're going to see what happens. As we come up, number one lane, working into that now turn lane, officers, lights going in that intersection there, stopping that traffic. We'll see what happens. Even though we're a little far away, we'll hear what happens as well, and I'll report that to you. And it looks like we're turning to the west and then back to the east. So maybe that was an attempt at a spike strip. It's hard to say, but it looks like the suspect was trying to avoid something, and with that kind of layout there, that definitely could have been a spike strip attempt. And at those low speeds, it is possible that that suspect saw that spike strip and avoided it. Now, the way spike strips work is they are a retractable strip that the police can lay out in the roadway, and it has little spiked tubes across it. Those tubes puncture the tire of the suspect vehicle and stick in those tires and begin to let the air out of those tires slowly and bringing those tires to a flatten, and then those tires will make the vehicle undrivable or break off, and then the vehicle will have no traction and unable to drive as well. So there's a few different options there. That's how those work, if those are going to get involved. But we're still not hearing on the scanner that those were involved. Still working very slowly here. Northbound on Broadway through 43rd Street, my apologies, about 30 miles an hour. This is what we've been watching for the last hour, working our way along the 110 freeway on the east side of Broadway, back to the north towards downtown. And if this suspect is following in any sort of pattern, at some point here in the near future, we'll see that suspect turn back to the east and kind of do another big circle into that turn lane, stop traffic both ways with that green light, luckily, but still continuing northbound. We're working our way through the LAX airspace. Those air traffic controllers doing a great job of getting us through when it's safe to do so. So as we continue northbound, we're going to get a little better shot, and we'll try to get a shot at some point inside that passenger side to see if we do see a passenger in that vehicle. It did look like we saw hands or legs in there at some point when we were over the front of the vehicle earlier. But back to the east now. Here we go on about, let's see, Vernon, and this is where the suspect turned to the east last time. So there is some sort of pattern that we're starting to see as the suspect works their way through the South L.A. area here, and we'll just have to see how the CHP decide to bring this to an end as we continue on. Over an hour now, CHP in pursuit of this vehicle wanted for failing to yield. That's right, Micah. It's sort of a cat and mouse game as we make our way through the South LA area now, Central and about 52nd Street, working our way back southbound. But time is on those officers' side. The one thing, or they have a lot of things that the suspect doesn't have in this situation. The suspect only has one tank of gas, one set of brakes, one set of tires. Those officers behind the suspect, the CHP, they have as many resources as they need, that, and they can switch out like a game of leapfrog or a relay race and trade off as necessary to continually pursue this vehicle. And in some cases, if those ground units have to back out, that air unit can still stick overhead. And even if that air unit needs to go get fuel, they'll just call another one in. So the suspect isn't getting away from any of those officers anytime soon, that's for sure. But still working our way southbound on Central, working up to Slauson, into that left turn lane. Now wrong side of the road, red light. Luckily, no cross traffic. We'll see what happens here. Slowly through the intersection and continuing southbound again. We'll just pull out a little wider, show you we have 1, 2, 3, 4 CHP units, and then at least three what looks like unmarked vehicles behind this as well. So a lot of attention by the authorities involving this vehicle, wanted for failure to yield, possibly some involvement of a narcotics investigation as well. We're hearing from the Sheriff's Department, but that's not confirmed at this time. But they are taking this cautiously, a little more cautiously than we've seen in the past, that's for sure. They are still continuing here southbound Central, about 62nd Street here in the South Los Angeles area. Let's stop at this intersection. That's right, Micah. And well, that might be the reason we haven't seen any larger accidents or anyone injured in this. And that's due to those lower speeds. Vehicles, other travelers in the area are able to hear those sirens and see those lights and slow down and yield them just like that. They have other units like that one you saw roll up there in the area that are stopping major intersections to prevent any accidents as well. So a lot of different tactics being used to keep the the public safe, but one of those is just the speeds. With those lower rates of speed, the vehicle doesn't pop, the suspect doesn't necessarily scare other passengers or other vehicles as much as it would at, say, like 70 miles an hour on this stretch of road. Now, something I get asked often by viewers and people is, well, how can the CHP be in pursuit on surface streets? Like, there aren't they, like, only freeways and things like that? Well, they can work on the surface streets because they are a state police, and they can kind of take up jurisdiction anywhere if they are requested. Now, we usually see them on the freeways because that's the area they patrol, but they have the ability and they have the want to keep the public safe no matter where they are. So so on surface streets like this, they're going to hold that pursuit unless another agency wants it, and then they'll let them take over. But for now, the CHP is staying involved. Here at about Florence and Alameda, we'll see what happens here. Continuing eastbound now, and this is probably the farthest east we've gone, is over Alameda since we arrived overhead, but eastbound Alameda into the area of Florence now, and still holding about 20 to 40 miles an hour. That's the range we're watching, running those red lights. As it goes on, the CHP is still right on the suspect's tail. Now, I can tell you, if I push back here just a little bit, is they have two canine officers here on scene as well. So they are prepared for anything when this comes to an end. Those canine officers can be brought out, and they are extremely beneficial in a foot pursuit. They can run a lot faster than their human companions can. So they are used as a great resource when it comes to apprehending suspects. And so they have two canine units here on scene with the suspect. We might have that ability to see in that passenger seat, and there is a passenger in that front seat. We see that arm of that passenger there kind of moving around. So at least two people still in this vehicle. A third person did flee from the vehicle earlier in the pursuit. Before we arrived overhead, but the airship did call out where that person was going to those ground units so that they could be apprehended. But this pursuit of this Honda CRV still continuing over an hour now, almost an hour and a half since we first heard this pursuit come out, and over an hour that we've been on the air now with this pursuit through the area of now Huntington Park. You see those units weaving their way through the stop traffic to stay on this suspect's tail as we continue now southbound on Pacific Boulevard through Walnut Street here in Walnut Park, Mike and Cher. That's right. We're still working southbound Long Beach Boulevard. Best case scenario, stay inside, lock your doors, because Not only have we seen pursuits end on sidewalks, on in the middle of the street with pedestrians, we've seen pursuits end in the suspect run into a home. So keeping yourself safe and indoors is the best option if you are in this area and you're watching it. Just make sure that you are safe and the doors are locked. Still continuing southbound Long Beach through the Southgate area. Those units still on scene. That primary unit, that Dodge Charger we see right behind the suspect vehicle, has been on this pursuit as long as we have. So they're probably working on an hour right now. And that could be extremely taxing on a police officer. They train for this, and they train very rigorously for pursuits and staying involved in them. But I can tell you from experience on working on a pursuit course for a day is that it's very exhausting being involved in these as well. Just due to the nature of having to weave through traffic, watch for other people, keep the public safe, and then keep an eye on that suspect and what they're doing, it can be extremely taxing. So that officer there doing a great job of staying involved. They have those other officers involved as well, just in case that primary unit needs a break. But right now that Dodge Charger is still sticking with this suspect right now. As we now continue westbound on Firestone from Long Beach Boulevard, we've been here before in the last hour, making that extremely large circle around the South L.A. area, still in the Southgate area. I apologize for the lighting right now. We're starting to see that sun get a little lower and kind of reflect off the street. Turning now southbound on Santa Fe from Firestone. This is a little different for us, speeding up a bit, about 40 miles an hour as we continue in southbound. And this has just been the name of the game. The police have been following the suspect from a very close distance for a majority of the pursuit. And it's just it's interesting that we haven't seen that pit maneuver, Mike and Cher, but the police sure have probably a good reason for that. And especially if we're now seeing undercover units behind the vehicle and things like that, they may know something about these suspects inside the vehicle that we don't. And so to keep everyone safe, they're just sticking with the tactic of sticking with the vehicle, seeing where it ends, the pursuit ends, and then apprehending the suspect at that time. But the question is how long will this go on? How big is that tank of gas? How well is that car maintained? And how long is it going to last as it makes its way through these intersections, slamming on brakes, and just continuing on now westbound on Southern Avenue, going through Stanford, Mike and Cher. That's right. They have that ability to kind of hand the baton off to a new office or a new officer who can take over the pursuit and begin to call this pursuit fresh, get a new set of eyes on that bumper. There's a thing called bumper lock. There goes the CHP airship overhead. And I believe they just switched out, but into that center divider kind of weaving now. That was for no reason, so very erratic move there. But as the pursuit goes on, it can be very easy for those officers, when they get fatigued, to have something called bumper lock, which is kind of like tunnel vision happen, and they just get so focused on that vehicle that they stop forgetting, or they stop paying attention to the rest of the equation, all the other vehicles, the traffic, the intersections. And so at some point, the supervisors decide to switch out vehicles, turning into a parking lot now. We'll see what happens here. And it looks like we have a CHP unit on the other end there, and going to try to box the suspect in. We'll see what happens. And pushing past that CHP unit there, that canine unit. Now that canine unit, the primary in the pursuit now, and we'll see what happens as this continues now on Walnut from about Pacific Boulevard, or it looks like we're on California from Pacific Boulevard. And now the airship calling this overhead, that new unit in that number one spot. But that was a great move by the CHP to attempt to bring this to an end. Coming in for that pit maneuver, going to tap that bumper just a little too far, spinning that vehicle the other way out of control. We'll see what happens. Going to box this vehicle in now. And it looks like the suspects have their hands out. We're going to hold just a little bit wider of a shot until we're kind of sure of what the situation's going to pan out yet now. You can see the canine officers being deployed or being brought out and ready in those stances there. You got a canine on each side of the vehicle, and those officers beginning to take that position of advantage. Now time is on those officers' side as they begin to call the suspects out of the vehicle, but I'm going to push in just a little bit closer now, and you can see the driver and the passenger have their hands out of the vehicle. That's the airship overhead calling that as well. They don't see anything else necessarily wrong. The airship also giving descriptions of the suspects. So in the situation that the suspects do get out and run, the officers on the ground and those dispatchers know what the suspect looked like, so they could put that out and get those suspects apprehended. But now they're going to call that passenger out of the vehicle. That passenger put their right hand down, and they're going to open that passenger vehicle, that passenger door, step out of the vehicle, turn around, face away from the officer. The driver doesn't look like they put that car in park, and it's going to roll right onto that sidewalk and probably right into a tree. Driver back in the vehicle, putting it into park. The officers now make an approach to that vehicle, telling that driver to put it into park and step out. That passenger sprawling out on the ground, hands above their head, hat off, and it looks like the officers are going to make approach to take that passenger into custody. And now it's just a matter of getting that driver out of the vehicle, who now looks like they're going to be coming out of the passenger side window, hands above their head. Same situation. They're going to try to get that driver to turn around, just make sure that the driver doesn't have any weapons, lay down, and then they'll take this driver into custody as well. Now, when both of these suspects are in custody, that doesn't take away the danger from the situation. At that point, they have to clear the vehicle and make sure that there's nothing else or no one else in the vehicle that could harm anyone, could harm the public. You can see that officer there in the vest doing that right now, looking inside that vehicle to make sure that there's no danger inside that vehicle. And then here any moment, if that officer deems the vehicle safe, they're going to call a code 4. The scene is safe is what that means, and it'll be a successful end to this pursuit termination here in the Walnut Park area. You can see the southbound traffic here of, I believe this is California Street, is blocked. Northbound traffic is being diverted out of the area. Both driver and passenger are in custody. Doors are opening, it looks like the officers are beginning to walk away from the vehicle with a little more ease. So and now a situation deemed safe here. Two suspects in custody after this more than an hour-long pursuit here in South L.A., Micah and Chair. Copy. Hey, Matt.